Hey, Adam from Tested here, and here is a pretty amazing place. I am in the middle of a room that is totally overwhelming. I am in one of the main hangars of the Smithsonian Air and Space Museum specifically, and behind me is the Space Shuttle Discovery. It's hard to describe what it's like to see one of these in person. The fact is what people have told you, which is that pictures don't do it justice, is totally true. And I actually have some history with the shuttles because I worked on the shuttle for Space Cowboys, and NASA cooperated with that film. So we got these orthographic layouts of all the tiles on the shuttle, and seven of us spent 6 months building this 8-foot-long shuttle, and we scribed every single tile into the surface, and we used luminized tape with quilting pattern on it to do the white patterning. I've spent a week alone on just the surrounds for the windows of the cockpit and 4 months detailing the inside of the payload bay. And still, after all of that intimacy with one of these machines and all of its construction, this is the third shuttle I've seen in person, and it is always overwhelming and magnificent. We are going to talk shortly to Lisa Young, who was one of the people responsible for bringing this in and getting it ready for display. I have no idea what's entailed with getting an object that large and gargantuan. One, how you move it. Two, how you prepare it for the public to view. All right, Lisa, I know you tend to work on more discreet objects, but how do you prepare something this gargantuan for display?
Well, it's the same. I mean, they're made of the same material. So whether it's a spacesuit or the space shuttle, we treat all our objects the same. And as a matter of fact, the space shuttle, which is interesting to me, is made of the same materials that spacesuits are made out of.
Really?
So these blankets that you see on top of the shuttle that's protecting it from heat and thermal entry and things are all made of that beta cloth.
They feel the same as
this? They're the same. They just have a different coating.
Okay.
And it's just interesting, the application between the two. I mean, we still need a good environment to keep them on in the museum. Mm-hmm. We'd like to keep all their battle scars, as we call it, so we don't clean anything. We don't take any evidence of space off. We don't remove any dust particles that may have happened during space or damage from the space flight or reentry. We want the visitors to see them exactly how they were in flight and when they were used.
Are there any, there must be considerations about how it's going to live the next few decades of its life sitting here and not deteriorate.
Right, this is a little bit harder because the building is actually the display case.
Right.
And so for a museum person, we don't like to have things out where there's light and, you know, humans and all these things that can interact with our objects. But it's too big, obviously.
Yeah.
It's huge. We built this building for it. We had Enterprise here before, the test model.
Right.
So we just, you know, when it came in, it was a perfect place for it. But we really have to keep the environment stable, watch you know, the perimeter, make sure, you know, we're not having special events around it, the lighting is good, and that people who see it on the floor, like, we keep it clean, we use special cleaning techniques, and all those jobs are things that we do every day to make sure that it can stay on display for the public.
Once it arrives in the build, well, first of all, how do you... you said you built the building for it, so clearly you built a door big enough
for
it to
come on
through.
Well, we were expecting, so we had the other one. So we are on the airport property, luckily.
Right.
We have a lot of our collections that just fly in, which is amazing for our museum. So this taxied over on the 747 from NASA. They landed at the Dulles Airport, and then we pulled it over with a tow bar that they use, the tow truck, you know, and to our museum for the ceremony, and then brought it into the museum.
Now, once it gets here, and you have to attack it to get it ready, do you have a picture in your mind of, like, I'm going to need 19 people, or...
Well, luckily NASA handled all of this because there were teams of people assigned to different things. They had to defuel it. They had to process it. They had to clean certain parts. They had to shut certain things down.
Were there certain things they pull off for research?
They did. They were here about 3 weeks processing it, and we worked with their teams. We went inside. They showed us, like, you know, don't touch this, don't step here ever, because inside especially, it's made for flight. So you do not step anywhere. It's all blankets. It's like you should be in no gravity because you're supposed to be floating. And the astronauts, you know, used it that way. So we had to put bridges down inside. And they really walked us through everything. They left their manuals. It was amazing.
That's totally. So you obviously got to know it pretty well after
it arrived. Somewhat, yeah.
Okay, so I'm curious if there's some aspect about it that surprised you or that was, like, new knowledge you did not know before.
Well, it's mostly like an aircraft frame, except for the covering. So when the payload bay's open to space, all of that has to have the same protection that the outside did. The coolest thing inside that people haven't seen is that there's an EVA footprint on those blankets.
Oh, really?
Inside the space shuttle on the wall, which were pointed out to us when they processed it. So all of that stuff we really worked hard with NASA, do not remove. Like, we want history here. But when they open those, you know, to launch the Hubble or whatever they're doing, all of the inside is exposed.
Amazing.
So, you know, they had to use all these certain protections. The EVA lock, which is my favorite because of the spacesuits.
Yeah.
They actually enter them like in this lockdown tunnel and then attach themselves to the wall and get in their spacesuits. All of the equipment is upside down. So when they come back inside from space doing the EVA, they have to turn themselves around. It's really pretty surreal in there. Like, it was just nothing I had sort of imagined. So
I got to climb inside one of the simulators at Johnson, and I couldn't believe how small the space inside is.
It's like a tiny shower or something where they're both standing and suiting up and,
That's crazy.
So they talk about it being bigger, but it's smaller than the command module where people would have suited up the first time.
Right.
Yeah. So
I find myself in its presence both feeling like it's bigger and smaller than I thought at the same time. It's gargantuan, and yet I can't believe it's as discreet enough to be contained.
Yeah, it's a pretty amazing. Like, I'm used to it being here, but I still, when you walk around it, it seems big.
Right.
But when you're just looking at one part of it, it doesn't. And yeah, it's a pretty amazing piece of equipment, I think.
Well, thank you for showing this to me. That's amazing.
Sure, yeah.
I really wish we could get inside.
Well, there is a 3D scan that Google did now of the entire interior that we worked with them on. It's on the web.
Oh, okay.
So we can get you the link, but like it's out there and available, and we did that so people could go inside, but not go inside.
Yeah.
Which is why we're using 3D scanning technology a lot with artifacts now.
I spent a lot of time in the Apollo command module.
Yes, so did
that,
I.
The exact thing.
Yeah, but I
virtually,
still see things
actually
in there. I'll check, you know, there too for my records. It's like, oh.
That's awesome.